So hi, hello everyone again, Microbehunter here, and welcome to another weekly microscopy live stream. Yeah, today at a slightly different time, due to personal reasons I had to move the live stream a little bit. So it's 12 hours later, later than normal, almost 12 hours later, so it's basically at a different time. Might be more convenient for some of you and less convenient for others. But still I hope that you found some time to join me today. Today's live stream I won't quite make as long, so a maximum maybe an hour or so. And then maybe starting next week I'd like to go back to the Saturday schedule, but occasionally do have appointments and then I'm not able to make it. Today I would like to do the following. I would like to try out my stereo microscope using conventional microscope slides. That's not something that you normally do. Stereo microscopes are designed to observe objects that are opaque, basically that do not allow light to go through. And slides like these here, they actually are designed to be very thin. The specimen is very thin and transparent. So essentially, I simply would like to test my stereo microscope, and we're going to do a little bit of a comparison here. That's basically what I would like to do for an hour. Over here, maybe later on, I've promised a few weeks ago, I put some diatomaceous earth under the microscope, fossilized diatoms, and I made some permanent slides. And later on at the end, maybe for about 5 minutes or so, I'd like to show them to you, not under the stereo microscope, but under the regular conventional microscope, because I promised this as well. So these are basically slides that I would simply like to add later on. Basically, I also would like to remind you that 2023, we're celebrating 300 years of Anthony van Leeuwenhoek. He is actually one of the first microscopists he made his microscopes 300 years ago, and I thought, well, it would be kind of nice if we were to celebrate his achievements. And if you want to make videos and upload them to your own YouTube channel, it doesn't even have to be a separate channel, pretty much everyone already has you can upload to YouTube. If you have a Gmail account, you simply upload your videos there, and if you add this hashtag to the title, for example, then it's much easier to find it, and then we can maybe celebrate in August or September, we can celebrate 300 years anniversary together. Okay, so this is a little bit the idea, a little bit of a community project to get people motivated. So what I'll do before I look at some of the slides, I would like to show you first my stereo microscope, which is fairly new, which is new. I would also like to show you these two things here, which I got separately. These are so-called Barlow lenses, which I can attach at the bottom of the stereo microscope. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to switch over to the stereoscope here. Okay, now it's still black, but I hope the camera will switch on. Okay, here I've already put a slide on here. I just show you, see the light intensity. So this basically is the stage, okay? And this is where you normally put opaque objects. For example, over here, this is a little fly, okay? That you can look at. I pinned it on this cork. Last time I already showed it to you. Normally you put those here under the microscope, but today some microscope slides. Okay, now if you want to look at the microscope slides, there are two ways that you can do that, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about those Barlow lenses, which I'm probably not going to connect because they're not necessary, but I still would like to talk about those. Now in here there are different possibilities about lighting. Yeah, you can see that the camera is a little bit slow here. First of all, you can have light from the bottom. Yeah, that's basically, and you see that the camera is adjusting a little bit here. So this is because there is, I'm going to show this to you. I'm going to turn it off again, otherwise it's too bright. Because if you remove this here, there is, of course, an LED in here. Okay, it's kind of self-explanatory. So you see there's a little LED in here, and then you've got this diffusing filter that goes on top. So that is one possibility. So a light from the bottom. Over here on the other side, I can show it to you. So that's, there are knobs that you can turn. And there's another knob over here on the other side. I don't know if you're able to see this. Okay. Yeah, here, over there. Okay. Yeah, and when I turn that the other knob, then I'm able to get a light from the top. Okay. And this will again cause the image to be a little bit different, because it depends quite a bit on how opaque the object is. And I have a third lighting, which I basically the microscope did not come with, but I bought it separately. I'm going to turn this off, and that is a so-called a ring light. Here I'm going to show it to you as well. Here, got to move a little bit back. Okay, so here this here is a ring light, an LED ring light that you can connect. And over here on the side, there is also a little knob that you can turn. To turn up the brightness and turn it down again. Okay, so I'll be working with three different lighting systems today, and experimenting. And I would like to also show you the slide also using my my normal, not normal, the compound microscope as well, because yeah, it will actually. The answer is a little bit, how do you say, in between. The image quality, of course, using a stereo microscope, a high magnification, it cannot be as quite as high as the one with a compound microscope, because the design is simply different, but it works surprisingly well. So, and for those of you who are kind of new to microscopy, stereo microscopes are, again, not designed, or strictly speaking, to observe slides like this, okay? Yeah, they have different strengths, but it still works surprisingly well. So that's what I'll be doing today. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to, as always, go quickly back through the comments. Yeah, I will jump over all of the hello around the world. Okay. Are there questions that can still be answered in this level of microscopy? Okay. I'm a little bit at this level of microscopy. I'm not quite sure whether I understand the question. I guess you mean, is are there still questions, scientific questions, that can be answered using stereo microscopes? Maybe that is the question. I say, of course, definitely yes, for heaven's sake. Otherwise, they would not be made and they wouldn't exist. It depends quite a bit. So for example, stereo microscopes like I have here are used, for example, and that's a big use, in the sciences, by people who study insects. If you want to do, for example, a biodiversity analysis of insects, then you need stereo microscopes. I recently, 2 weeks ago, talked to an entomologist, an insect specialist. I asked him about his stereo microscope, and he told me he needs high magnification stereo microscopy to be able to count the hair of different ants, because the distance and the number of hair growing on the ant determines which species of ant it is. Now you're gonna worry or wonder, who cares about the ant species? But that is important because of environmental pollution, climate change, whatever. You have a change in insect species happening. And for example, some insects are very important for pollination of plants, therefore, by identifying which insects are there, you can actually, this has a direct impact on agriculture, because the insects are pollinating. So you need to do some kind of a biodiversity assessment study, just to give you one specific example. So what I'm trying to say here is that stereo microscopes in the sciences, in biology specifically, of course, play a very very critical role. It just depends how it is used. Okay. Okay. So greetings from all over the world. Okay, I'm going to just jump over the general questions here. Are protists visible in stereo microscopes? The short answer is yes. You can see them, but not very well. Protists are single-celled microorganisms which are fairly large, like Paramecia, for example. You can see them, but not very well, because they're kind of transparent. Okay, and the thing that really makes protists interesting is if you actually look into the cell. So the answer is again yes, but maybe stereo microscopes are not really ideal for that. Okay. I have a gigantic garden here, and my neighbor has a big lotus pond, and I think I might get some sample from there. Yes. Okay. So what I'll be doing now is I now want to switch back to the desk view, and I want to show you some of the attachments that I'm able to make here, which I'm just going to show you what's possible. So my microscope, you can attach those so-called Barlow lenses on the bottom, and this makes doubles the magnification. And this one over here reduces the magnification. Now you're going to ask, why do you want to reduce the magnification? The reason is because this is another advantage. You're able to increase the distance between the object and the objective. Okay, so you can put larger objects in here by connecting this one here. And this one, of course, has the disadvantage that essentially it's got to be very close. So actually, I tried it, and if you actually want to be able to see the slide with a 2x bar low, in addition, it's got to be very close. Yeah, and that's already makes it difficult also with the light. So I'm not going to use those. Okay, because I think we're going to be completely fine with the one that I have here. So again, let's look at the stereoscope, and I will quickly show you when it appears. Okay, I'm going to go up here, and I'm going to just show you here what I've got here on the top. I need to move it back again here. There is a knob that I can turn, and this is the, yeah, you see, I'm able to change magnification around. Okay, the lowest objective magnification I have to look here is 0.65. So with a 10x eyepiece, I'm getting a 6.5x magnification. Again, the magnification through the camera again is calculated differently. And if I go in all the way, okay, then the maximum is it says here 55 times. Just a second. 0.65 gives me a 6.5, and this one here gives me this is a 5.5 times objective times 10, a 55 times magnification. Okay, by adding those Barlow, I can go over 100 times. Yeah, but then it's really going to be quite blurry. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to focusing happens over here by turning, of course, the knob here on the side. Okay, you can see that essentially, the focus changes. What I'm going to do now is, I'm going to now try out different types of lighting. You just also need to note that the camera will also readjust them every time so that the exposure is kind of correct. So what you're seeing right now, let's go to the lower magnification because I think that's then it also has a greater depth of field a little bit here. So right now, light coming from the bottom, okay? Light coming from the bottom, okay? Let's focus a little bit. I'm now going to switch this off. Light from the ring lamp. Okay. This is how it looks here. Also works quite well. And then when I turn that off and the other one on, there is also a separate lamp on the side here. Yeah. It also works quite well. And the reason why this seems to work is because the light bounces through the slide and is reflected from the bottom. So even though light is coming from the top, there is still some light also shining in from the bottom. What I have now is I also have those here. Okay, look, you can instead of using an LED from the bottom, you can also put in those. It's made of plastic plates. And let's have a look here at this now. I'm going to take this off, and let's use this one over here. I have to find the thing again, the center again, and this is how it looks like with a black surface. You see those white little dots that you see in the background, these are simply, it's dust and it's also reflected light. But you see that, when the bottom absorbs light because it's black, then you're not able to see a lot. So those slides essentially still need to have light coming from the bottom. I'm saying this because there are some stereo microscopes out there that only have light from the top. For example, my other stereo microscope that I bought, I said it's just I don't need to have light from the bottom, only light from the top. And if this is the case, then and you use a black background, then of course you're not able to observe slides. So that's basically my general advice. If you are interested in observing slides, make sure that and if you get a stereo microscope, make sure that you have light coming in from the bottom. But I'm going to show you something else. Maybe it's not such a big problem, because if I want to turn this around and use the white one, and then all of a sudden it seems to work again. Now what's going on? Well, very, very obviously, because let me put it here again, very obviously because the light bounces off the plastic surface and still starts to illuminate it from the bottom. Okay, even if light is coming from the top, the light is reflected from the bottom as well, and therefore you were able to see the slides. Yeah. So this is kind of a little bit important. I want to show you another little trick. If you do not have any light coming in, if you don't have any bottom light, you can also try the following. You can also try to place a, I'm going to show this to you now on the desk view, because I think this might be actually better. Okay. Yeah. To increase, you can actually also take a petri dish and put it on here, and maybe shine some light from the side and making it bounce upwards. Okay, so this would also be a possibility to get bottom illumination this way if your stereo microscope does not have light from the bottom. Okay, so this is a little bit the thing. And what I would like to do now is I'm just going to take this away again, and we're just going to have a look at some random slides that I've got. But you know what, just for the fun of it, because just for those of you who are not so familiar yet with microscopy, this is actually one of my more favorite, let's turn on my favorite specimens. I recently caught it. This is a fly. And this kind of shows what actually stereo microscopes are really good for. Okay. Last week, I think I already showed it to you, just for the sake of what they're actually good for. So that is, here is the fly. Yeah. Yeah, and so it's an opaque object. It does not allow light to go through. And what you can do is you can essentially focus all the way down, and you see the different parts come into focus and go out of focus. Yeah, and this is now, let's go up with the magnification again. Yeah, look at the compound eye. It's quite nice. Yeah, those little dots that you see here are basically individual. Ommatidia, they're called. Okay, yeah. Individual elements that catch the light. Those dots that you see here. Yeah, yeah. And one of the things that compound microscopes have is, and I'm going to turn on the arrow to illustrate this. Here we've got a little arrow. If I'm able to get it, just a second. Okay, here we go. Here's the arrow. You see that everything in here is in focus. And everything over here on the side is blurry, right? That's completely normal because the compound eye is not flat, it's bent. And if you're using microscope slides, then this of course makes it in that sense easier because everything is completely flat. And what I do is I focus down, and then you see the different parts will go in focus and go out of focus. And if you want to have still a completely flat an image which is complete, where everything is in focus, you can do some so-called focus stacking, which I'm going to show you separately because it's a separate video. What you do, just very briefly, is you take a video, you focus down, and you make a video of this, so with the different parts in and out of focus, and then you import the video into a program called Helicon Focus. And this program will then make an image which is completely in focus. So I'm just saying this a little bit to demonstrate to some of you who might not be so familiar with stereo microscopes what stereo microscopes actually are used for. So that's kind of the idea. But today, as I want to say, as I said before, I would like to observe a couple of slides. And those slides here, these are. I made a couple of months ago. These are varroa mites. Basically, mites are related to the spiders. They're not spiders, but they're related to the spiders. And let me turn this off. Let me turn the light on from the bottom. And they basically, I got them as a, you won't believe it, as a present. Because a student of mine had a beehive, and these are bee parasites. Okay. What I would like to do is I would like to show them to you here now under the stereo microscope. Let's put the arrow away. Okay. And then we're going to look at them under my compound microscope so that you again are able to see a little bit the difference. I think this video, this live stream is also a nice demonstration on what it means, difference between magnification and resolution means. Okay, so that's a mite, and we go. Let's start to zoom in a little bit here. It goes out of focus. I did not properly attach, not attach, but I didn't properly set it up yet. So I need to focus here. And this is how the mite now looks like. And I'm going up, oh, wrong direction, I'm going up even yet further. Okay. The camera, yeah, brightness always readjusts, and I'm focusing now again, and yeah, let's remember a little bit how this looks like, okay, concerning clarity and things like this, because I'm going to put it just in a minute or so under my other microscope, I think I have to tell you, I think it works surprisingly well, but you're going to see it just in a minute or so when I put it under my other microscope, that the clarity in the compound microscope is going to be quite a bit higher. The resolution is going to be higher, okay? So yeah, because there's a condenser there and so on, and it's the objective is also much closer to the specimen, yeah? And again, for those of you just to join, the reason is because what I'm doing right now is I'm using the stereo microscope not for its intended purposes, okay? So this is not to say that the stereo microscope is not able to work quite as well. No, it's stereo microscope has different intended purposes, and still I think that the image quality is surprisingly good. Okay, so I'm going to stop again here, and I'm going to read a couple of questions. Do you put mold under the stereo microscope? If yes, did you see the spores and the hyphae? Yes, I have done this. I don't have mold right now here with me, but I did put mold under the microscope. And yes, a couple of years ago in this channel, I actually do the following: a search for rotten tomato under the microscope. Or better yet, I put a toast with mold under the microscope, under a stereo microscope. Yeah, there was this moldy toast in this channel, okay? Search for it. I'm holding up a toast with some black mold on it, okay? I made it a couple of years ago, so you might have to go back a little bit in the video history. And there, I'm also, I used my other stereo microscope, and I put some mold also under the stereo microscope. Okay, so isn't the Barlow lens element with called a reducer? The thing is the following. Those Barlow lenses, essentially, that's quite interesting. There are two different types of Barlow lenses. Barlow lenses for stereo microscopes, you attach on the bottom of the objective, and then there are Barlow lenses, which I generally don't recommend because they're not needed, for compound microscopes that you connect beneath the eyepiece. Okay, so this is basically the kind of function differently. In one case, if you add a magnifying Barlow lens on the bottom of the objective, it actually increases the magnification. And if you add a Barlow lens in where the eyepiece is, it actually decreases it. So that's why you have to use one that kind of spreads it apart. Yeah. So that's why you need a magnification of less than one if you want to get a larger image. At the eyepiece, yeah. So that's kind of different, yeah. So in other words, if you add a 0.5 times on the bottom of the objective, then you're getting a smaller image. If you add a 0.5 times at the eyepiece, you're going to get a larger image. Okay. Both are called Barlow, but actually the factor does something different depending on whether you have it on the bottom or on the top. Okay. So. Can you also use an LED panel or an old smartphone display to illuminate the slides from the back? As a matter of fact, can you use smartphones? Yes, you can do that. I think I actually tried this once. If you want to use smartphone panels as an LED, put some paper over it so that you don't see the pixels so much. Okay, but you can use also, and people I think have already done this, not only an LED panel. The problem with LED panels is that you can sometimes see the individual LED lights, because especially for those that are used for photography, like photography lighting, sometimes you see the LED lights, but there are some panels, especially if you want to look in the old days, film negatives, for example, or doctors sometimes use it to look at x-rays, you can use this, yeah? But there's one important, very important thing here is before you run out and get yourself an LED panel, you should be able to somehow adjust the brightness, and not all LED panels allow you to do that, yeah? If fly looks so different under a stereo microscope, yes. As a matter of fact, that's one of the reasons why when we do microscopy in school, or I'm a teacher, we often look at insects, because it kind of connects the people better with their environment. Yeah. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to switch over now to my other microscope. Okay, so that's the varroa mite, and in my other microscope now the compound microscope. Let's have a look here. So let's move out this here. This is I cannot look through it now because So let me flip out the condenser. Okay, you see also some of dust and dirt. And that is now using the low power 4x objective, and you see already that the image quality is much more clear. Yeah. And the reason is, this kind of illustrates a little bit the difference between magnification and resolution. So that is now the 10x objective, and we're able to see now the individual hair as well. Now, why is the resolution so much higher here? Well, for several reasons. First of all, one important criterion is that the distance between the objective and the specimen is much smaller here. Yeah? So therefore, the objective is able to capture much more detail. Yeah? So the purpose is of a stereo microscope and a compound microscope is very different. And how am I going to put this one over here, for example, under the compound microscope? I cannot really do that very well. I mean, there is a possibility, maybe a little bit, by using the low power 4x objective and using a flashlight. I've also done this already before, but in reality, the compound microscope is not designed to do that. Yeah? So let's look again at a couple of other things with the stereo microscope. Over here, for example, I do have. It's an these are onion. Epidermis cells, yeah. And look at this. Actually, yeah. That's already the maximum magnification. And I have to tell you, yeah, we are able to see not only the individual onion cells, but also the nuclei. I think the specimen is not so good because it's too stained a little bit too strongly. But the individual dots that you see in here occasionally, yeah, inside the cell, these are the nuclei. Yeah, and they can be seen quite easily. Okay, so let's have a look now under the compound microscope, and let's put it in here. And of course, I have to refocus. Looks a little bit more brightness. Looks fairly Yeah, that's basically the comparison now under the compound microscope. Course much more light coming in from the bottom because the light is all concentrated to one point. Yeah. But honestly, I have to tell you, I'm pretty happy with the stereo microscope. I really did not expect the quality of the stereo microscopes are quite that usable still for microscope slides for So see, now it's black because my where is this? Sometimes the camera strikes a little bit. Yeah, here we go again. Yeah, so I have to switch off and on the camera again. So that's basically again under the stereo microscope. Yeah. So insects have an exoskeleton which can be preserved well if dried properly. Some people collect insects, butterflies, for example. Yeah. The softer parts may shrink a bit, but the rest will remain in good condition. I mean, I have a friend who used to, when he was a youngster, he used to collect the butterflies as a hobby, and he told me that he has to not only dry them properly, but he was kind of injecting some kind of a substance, alcoholic or some substance, into the insect to make sure that everything dries out properly and to preserve everything properly. Here we've got a butterfly, butterfly one. I'd like to start arranging butterfly scales. Can you suggest an adhesive to hold the scales in place so the mounting medium doesn't float my arrangement apart? Well, the adhesive honestly is the mounting medium. So what I suggest is the following. There is the general problem. If you want to make mounting media, if you want to make microscope slides like those here, and where's the desk here? Then of course there's the problem if you have a scale and you put the scale or any object on there and then you put the cover glass on top, then the cover glass, which kind of goes down on the slide, pushes everything away and it's not centered anymore. So what I probably would suggest is the following, is that you put a little bit of mounting medium on a tiny amount, okay, on the slide, and you use the butterfly scale and you put it into this amount of mounting medium and you allow it to dry a little bit. Okay, so that it's able to not move anymore. And then once it's dried a little bit, you can add the remaining mounting medium. So that would be a possible suggestion that you might want to try out. Is the varroa mite in Uperol or Elmer's glue? Very easy answer. It is in Uperol. And the reason I put it into Uperol is because it clears the exoskeleton. It becomes more transparent. I did make some time ago a live stream and some videos where I compared those two. Again, a couple of months back, which kind of showed that the Uperol actually clears, has this clearing action. Okay. Yes, it's a good idea to have a distance between the light and the specimen to blur the background. Yes. Okay. Also, you can't lower the light output to add more diffusion layers to darken it. Yeah. If you cannot lower, yes. So that is essentially one of the issues here. Let me have another one. This one over here is a tick, not nicely mounted. I have to tell you, it's not so nicely mounted, but I just had it. Because occasionally I'm also bitten by ticks, especially during summertime. Not a good thing. Deactivate and activate again. My camera sometimes is a little bit giving me some problems here. Here it is. Okay, this is an example of a badly mounted specimen slide. Badly mounted because you see that the mounting medium here. Is here, that's the mounting medium here, and that's air. So did not add enough mounting medium here. So a couple of years ago I got bitten by this tick. I carefully pulled it out. Not a good idea to be bitten by ticks because they do carry diseases. So you got to be careful. But I think this must also be Uperol because the exoskeleton is relatively transparent. And I have to tell you, I'm surprised by the the STEREOMICROSCOPE is able to produce such a high image quality here, comparatively. It's a little bit blurred out. Let's try the following. I just want to see how does this look like if I put on, no, that's too much light. Let's turn off the light from the top. So this is I'm going to now try the following. I'm going to take this away and I'm going to put now a black background on here. I would like to see, maybe I'm able to have this is again a little too you see, that is the thing now, because of the Uperol the tick has become transparent and therefore it looks again different than for example the fly, which I just showed you, where you do not see the surface texture so very well. So this kind of also illustrates another thing. If you want to actually see the surface texture of insects and of mites and of ticks and so on, you probably, and you want to use it in a STEREOMICROSCOPE, you probably don't want it to be transparent. But because I added the Uperol now, it made it more transparent, and therefore you're not able to see the surface texture quite as well in comparison, for example, to this fly over here, right? Yeah. So you see, not so good. Okay. So I should not have. Mounted it in Uperol, but rather in kept it completely dark by not mounting it in there and simply having a maybe gluing it somewhere. So what else do we have here? That's a bird's feather. Go back again. No, that's the wrong direction. Let's zoom out again here. Again, let's put the other one in here. Okay, also very transparent. Let's have a look. Maybe we're going to turn up the light from the bottom. And here we're able to see the individual, they're called barbules. Let me refocus again. Again here, an example of where the people who prepared the slice attempted to make it very transparent. Therefore the contrast is a little bit low. Okay. Let's have a look at this under the other microscope. And let me see. Where is it? Yep. We have to go down a little bit. This is how it looks. Even here, the contrast is not the very high, not the highest. So, for example, a sheet of paper, yep. Have you ever tried dark field condenser? Yes, of course I have. Dark field condensers are actually not really used, or not needed, or they don't apply to stereo microscopes. Oh, I see what you mean, a dark field condenser. Let me correct here. If you want to see dark field, I don't know if it works here. Let me see. This here, for example, is dark field. Okay, you see that the image is bright on a dark background. What you can do is you can use a so-called dark field filter or dark field patch stop, which you put into the filter holder of your microscope, and then you get dark field. But there are also so-called dark field condensers. They have a mirror, so a round mirror on the inside, which redirects the light and which allows you to get dark field also for much higher magnifications. So I have not tried those dedicated dark field condensers. What I've done, of course, a lot is I've worked a lot with dark field filters. Okay, so that is okay. That's a very big air bubble, referring to the one with a tick. With a stereoscope, in my opinion, you can actually see more layers. You can actually see the shadow of the uprol there. I think what you mean with more layers is a greater depth, maybe. Okay. And it's much more immersive. Yeah, with a stereo microscope, something that it's not able to catch here is because I only have one camera, and the screen, computer screen, is of course only one screen. Is the really impressive thing with stereo microscopes is that you actually get a three-dimensional image. Yeah, so when you look through the eyepieces, you actually see the different parts of the insect or whatever object you look at stand out. Okay, that is actually the real advantage here, yeah? And this is something that I'm somehow not able to capture here. So I don't know, maybe in 10, 20 or 30 years as technology progresses, maybe we have monitors where by looking at it we're automatically already able to see it stereoscopically, three-dimensionally, but we're not there yet. Okay, the dark background on the stereoscope actually turns purple. I think this the reason why it looks purple is because it is not completely smooth, and basically depending on the plastic here, it kind of reflects the light differently. So it could be that could be a reason as well, or it could be maybe a little bit of chromatic aberration, which you always have. Yeah. The compound microscope has a higher magnification. Well, the compound microscope has a higher magnification. But the real difference is that the lens, the objective, is closer to the specimen, and therefore you have also a higher resolution. And that's actually the main difference. Yeah. Okay, greetings from a country known as Australia. Am I late? Well, today's video live stream won't be that long, so I'm still going to continue about 20 minutes. Can you do a video on how things look like in candlelight under the microscope? In candlelight, well, in candlelight, I tell you, you have a significantly stronger red component. So it will look a little bit with a reddish, slightly reddish, but also much darker. Yeah, and I think I would say that in the back in the day, the first microscopes where there was no electricity, yes, indeed they used I think a chemical reaction they used to actually create the light, and then the guy, it was Robert Hooke, he used a water-filled round glass container as a lens to focus the light on the specimen, actually using fire. Yeah, so this has been done, but I think these days we don't need this anymore. Yeah, so let's have a look at a couple of more slides. What do I have here? Let me check. Yeah, so Daphne and Cyclops, where do I have this? This is a sunflower. This is a small, okay. I'm just checking here a little bit. This is a polyp. Yeah, this is basically a slide of a polyp, which is a freshwater polyp, hydra. Let's have a look here. Again, transparent. Okay. Let's zoom out again here. Yeah, this is hydra. Again, these are commercially prepared slides, which are very convenient because You can just take them and place them around as you need them without having to worry about the any water spilling. But by the way, another thing that I might want to do in an upcoming live stream is to do a little bit of polarization microscopy over the stereo microscope by crystallizing vitamin C, for example. So it's quite easy to do as well. I didn't have time quite today to actually show that to you. This was my initial intention, but maybe in a future live stream I will actually show you how to do polarization, how to make very nice looking crystals using polarization. I bought myself just to show you a little bit here, I actually bought myself a polarization filter here, okay? It's also possible to do polarization work. But that is Hydra now, okay? Let's move in a little bit longer. Again, one of the more difficult things about a stereo microscope is that, of course, it does not have, it doesn't generally need a mechanical stage. But this, of course, makes it a little more, you need a little more patience in actually moving the slides around. So let's increase the light intensity again a little bit here. So this is Hydra under a stereo microscope, and if we want to look at this Hydra using a compound microscope, okay, so then I'm going to switch over again, compound microscope. Let's put the feather away. Let's put the dark field away, and here we go with the compound. If you're kind of wondering why the whole thing is in a circle, okay, you see that there is those black edges. That is because the condenser, look at what happens here. I've got a swing out condenser. You have to remove the condenser like this, and I have to also remove the polarization here. Adjust the light intensity again, and this is how it then looks like. Using four times, for 10 times I can put the condenser back into place again. And this is basically how it now looks like using a 10 times magnifying objective. Okay. So, what is the smallest microbe besides bacteria? Well, honestly, the thing is the following. Among the single-celled organisms, that's a difficult one. Do you consider viruses as microorganisms? Strictly speaking, not. It's a question of definition, right? The word organism, microbe, comes from microorganism, and an organism implies that it is alive. And per definition, viruses are not alive because they do not have their own metabolism. It's a question of definition, okay? Strictly speaking, the smallest living things that are possible are indeed bacteria, and some of them can be very small. I bought an Olympus CHA for 220 euros, local service of. Yes, I read this question here, also in one of your comments. So it's an Olympus CHA microscope. I have the same one as well. After time, what happens is that it becomes very difficult, knobs become very difficult to turn because the oil starts to solidify. And what I have done is I talked to a microscope servicing company, and they were certified to fix Olympus microscopes, and he was able to fix it for me, and I paid 200 euros. Okay. He took it apart, the coarse focus knob and the mechanical stage. And he cleaned everything and put it back together. I once tried to fix the mechanical stage of an Olympus CHA microscope using a manual, which you can download. There's a PDF online, and I did not manage. I didn't have the right tools to do that. Maybe I'm also not as competent in that, but try to fix the CHA microscope if you want to gain experience. I gave up because the mechanics is quite complex. Yeah, but if you're good in mechanical stuff, then it might be a project that you might want to embark on. But do take pictures, otherwise you're not going to remember how to put it together. And I kind of gave up. Okay, so it is. I'm just saying. I once put some dirty water under a microscope, and there was a thing. It was either a brown or yellow, and it was kicking up the dirt. It was small and slimy, what was it? Very difficult to say, because there are so many things in there. Yeah, and the color doesn't say a lot, because the color of microorganisms also depends a little bit on the food that they eat. Generally, what I always recommend is that you would, yeah, maybe post a picture somewhere, or what you can do is if you Google a little bit, there are online also some identification help, yeah, with a drawing, so that you're at least able to kind of sort out what could it be. Yeah, the weather is clearing up. I have to, yeah, okay. Yes, I also have a commercial slide of Hydra, but it looks weird because the body was significantly shorter and its tentacles were almost not visible. So the thing is the following. Hydra, basically they reproduce by so-called budding. This means that's one way that where a smaller Hydra grows out on the side. And of course, this depends very much on the individual slide and specimen that you have. Yeah. Not all hydras look the same, obviously. Also because, we're talking about a natural specimen that basically changes over time, and depending on. So there are no two slides of the same specimen that actually look the same. Yeah. Yeah. So it was under the dirt. I have no identification. The thing is the following: I have no identification and I couldn't take a picture. The biodiversity is so large and there's so many living things out there that essentially I have to tell you it might be difficult it's difficult to identify objects just by a verbal description. But if you give me 20 seconds, 10 seconds, I'll show you a book. Just a second. Where's my book? Yes, I actually bought myself some identification books as well, because this is a question that always keeps on reappearing. You see, there's always this copyright problem where I'm not allowed to show you the contents. This is the old version here. It's in German. It doesn't matter, okay? Because there are thousands of drawings in there. And those drawings basically help you identify it. And once you know the name, you can Google for it. This is an old edition. This is the new one. It's much thicker, okay? It's called The Life in a Drop of Water. It's not cheap, but this is a serious identification book, okay? If you want to see a couple, on Amazon, online, you can actually look at a couple of pages in there, but I don't know. I'm just going to tell you, it's 350, 400, over 400 pages, and on one side, it's full of drawings, and on the other side, there's a description with a name. Yes, the description is in German, but honestly, I think it's not even so important, because what you can do is you can get yourself Google Translate. There is this app, mobile phone app. You take a picture of whatever you want to have translated, and then you get the translation. But I think the more important thing is just the name. Yeah, and it's a highly recommended book. Okay, I recommend. Yeah. Highly recommended book that I recommend. That's some English. Okay, so this is a little bit about the identification part here. So let's have a look at a few more slides. So do I see? Yeah, one of my favorite ones is always the plant cross sections, because they really look beautiful. So let's have a look at some plant cross sections here again. This here is maize. Okay, I have to again see, that's a little bit of a technical thing here. I have to quickly deactivate and activate the camera again. Yeah, and if you're interested in this book, please check out Amazon. And in Amazon, you can also have a look inside where you can look into. They have a couple of PDF pages where you can look into it. However, I've seen that the main part of the book with all of the nice drawings is not included in the preview. So this might be something that you also take into consideration. This is the cross section of maize, of a stem. Let's go again a little bit with, let's go up with, some time ago I actually showed it to you as well. Yeah, here we go. It's actually really, I'm really happy with still with the image quality, because again, I know I'm repeating myself. This is not what stereomicroscopes are actually designed to do. there to look at opaque objects, but I'm really happy with that still the image quality is that nice. I'm saying this because you see, I do get emails and comments and questions that I want to buy a microscope for my child or together to do a little bit of microscopy, what's the right microscope? And I generally always recommend, well, if the kids are smaller, get yourself a stereo microscope because you can put flies and objects directly under the microscope without preparation work. But then I understand that sometimes people do want to look at slides as well, right? You commercially bought slides or you want to make some slides and you still want to look at those, yeah? And I just want to show you that, yeah, you can look at those slides also with a stereo microscope. And here, for example, I already talked about, these are the so-called the vascular bundles, which are the xylem and the phloem, which transport water up and nutrients down the plant. The individual cells can be seen. Yeah? So it's quite nice. Yeah. What about wood under the microscope? Wood. Oh gosh, where did I've got so many here. This is, I got to look at wood. As a matter of fact, where is it? Yeah, I do have some wood, I just don't know where to find it. Okay, I've got so many slide boxes here. Linde, Mais, Bier, Kartoffel, I'm reading the whole thing here. Yeah, it is, I should probably do a separate, just a second. If I can't find it, then yeah, I'm just not going to. Just a second, please. You want to look at wood because actually wood does look very nice as well. That's why I'm trying to find it here. But there are so many. No, sorry guys, I cannot find it right now. I cannot find wood right now. You know what? I'll try to remember it. I have it, but I've got over 100 slides here and I don't know where it is and it's not sorted and it is not sorted by alphabet, which is a little bit of a pity. Sunflower, yeah, bone, everything, nerves, liver, lungs, cyanobacteria. Okay, you know what? Sorry guys, I cannot find the wood now. I have it, but I gotta, yeah. This kind of disturbs me. Ah, number 40. Found it. Okay, okay, I found the wood. Okay, so let's do the following. This is basically pine wood. Pine wood. There are, it's a cross section and longitudinal sections. Let me zoom out a little bit here. See that there are, it's actually one of my favorite specimens here. So I look at this here. Yeah, this is pine wood under the microscope now. And of course you can see the individual cells here, but you can also see the yearly, the annual rings. So that's basically an annual ring, and that's the next ring, yeah. And in here, the individual cells. Also, yeah, I think, yeah, very, very nice. Yeah. So this is how it looks like under the stereo microscope, and of course, you also want to see how this is look like under the compound microscope. So let's put it in here. I have to switch over to microscope view, and where is it? That's it, I have to focus again. This is how it looks like under the compound microscope. So that is wood, pine wood. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, I really want is a Dolby digital microscope. Okay. If I accidentally consumed water with paramecium, would it infect me or would my immune system kill the paramecium? that's a good one. It won't even get that far as into the immune system. The acid in your stomach is going to digest it. It's very simple, okay? Don't worry about this. Chances are pretty good that you already have, yeah? Every time, I mean, I've read this somewhere that it's a little bit disgusting, but every year an average person consumes around 0.5 kilogram of insects, a pound of insects, in bread that we eat, in the vegetables that we eat, without knowing it, Yeah, so it doesn't matter. Yeah, and as a matter of fact, that's the reason why our stomach is so so aggressive, is because it is indeed a very important way of protecting the body. Most of the things are actually digested away. Yeah, yeah. So how would you make a wood slide though? Do you use a microtome? Wood is pretty tough. Yes, but what you can also try to do is the following. You can try to take a very sharp razor blade, and then you can try to cut some cork, just like Robert Hooke did back in the day, a couple hundred years ago. It is correct that it is difficult to do, but it is possible. So if you get yourself some soft wood, then you can actually, and a sharp, very sharp razor blade, you can actually also make hand cuts. I've tried that. It takes a lot of patience because many specimen samples are not going to be, are going to be too thick. But occasionally you're going to be lucky and you're going to get small slices that are thin. Yeah, so it is possible. For larger sections like this, you do need a microtome. Yeah. What time is it now? Okay. Well, what I'm going to do now in the last couple of last 5 minutes is because I promised this. So if I've seen that some of you have joined in a little bit late today, I'm already in the process of finishing the live stream. What I've done today is I've put some commercial microscope slides also under a stereo microscope. So I've been kind of using a stereo microscope for a wrong purpose, so to say. And I kind of tried to show you that it still works quite well. It is also possible to put objects, larger objects like small insects and so on, directly on a under here, using the low power magnification and then kind of shining some microscope, some flashlight on top, something that I've not done today. But what I would like to do now is I would like to change topics around, because I promised some of you this some time ago. I've got over here some four slides of diatomaceous earth that I wanted to show you as well. I put this diatomaceous earth into a nail polish as a mounting medium. Clear nail polish, Euperol, which is actually used for insects. Over here, this is Eukit. This is a resin-based mounting medium that is used also in medicine, but has the disadvantage that the solvent is not good. Okay, so you need fresh air. So I let it dry out on my balcony because I did not want to inhale the fumes. And this one is PVA glue, a water-based PVA glue. Yeah, and I basically made this some time ago, and I just want to show them to you simply because in the previous live stream I talked about those, and there have been questions, how do the slides do? And here they are. Okay, so I'm just going to quickly show them to you. And you're going to, we have to go up with the magnification a little bit. So this is a little bit of a different topic than what I normally would do, and I'm going to let's magnify this a little bit. I have to close this here. I have to go up with the light intensity. I have to find it. This is some dust and dirt. I'm using now DIC, so maybe I'm going to not use DIC simply to. So, and because those diatoms are a little bit small. Okay, and let's go up to 400 times. Okay, so this one is now using clear nail polish. And what you see over here, those little square-shaped structures. Okay, these are basically diatoms. These are fossilized diatoms that I, and I simply mixed a few of those. It's a powder with some nail polish, and I put it under the microscope, and that's how it looks like. Okay, so yeah, no bubbles. How can you prevent air bubbles? Well, I will show you something. You'll be surprised. There are plenty of bubbles. It's just a question of where you look, because here on the side, look at this. Yeah, there are bubbles. That is one of the things with nail polish. Nail polish likes to make a lot of bubbles. Yeah, but you know what? I say, well, actually, there are still plenty of places where there are no bubbles. So it's okay. So that is essentially one of the disadvantages of nail polish. But then again, you see, it's not that bad. So that's nail polish. So the nail polish kind of works. Euprobe, the one that essentially that's used mostly for insects. Let's go up again with the magnification. Again, the density might be different because here. And I'm just saying that why this the mounting medium matters is because it's a question of refractive index. Yeah, the refractive index has to be correct, otherwise you don't see them well. And I think you might be actually able to see them here in Euprobe a little bit better. So maybe the difference in there's a stronger difference in refractive index between the diatoms and the mounting medium. So that is basically Euprobe. Then let's go on. The next one, this is UKit. This is the resin-based one, yeah, which has a very long-term, yeah, preservation. But the specimens must be completely dry. It also works. And maybe most interestingly, let's have a look at the PVA one. The PVA is water-based. It's completely safe. It's a children's glue as well. The specimen does not have to be completely dry, and it doesn't make a lot of bubbles either. That's why I kind of like this this PVA glue. Let's have a look at this here. Again, I think the density might be a little bit too high, but maybe let's have a look at the refractive index here. This is, it also works. So what do we learn from this? Get yourself some clear PVA glue. It's called Elmer's glue. And try playing around with that if you want to make your own microscope slides, because in many cases it's gonna work. Yeah. So this is now the 60 times magnification. And let's contrast it again with the that's the PVA one with, let's say, the nail polish one from the beginning. Yeah, and of course I have to refocus a little bit. Also works. Yeah. So what shall I say? There are, at least concerning those diatom slides, a variety of possibilities here, at least for hobby purposes. If you want to preserve diatoms, if you're really serious about this, you probably would like to use a mounting medium that's actually designed more for diatoms, because you're able to see the details better then. Okay, how do I get my blood under the microscope if I want to see it without hurting myself? Okay, something that I have heard, never tried before. You can try it yourself. I will tell you what, because some doctors are doing this. How can you actually observe your, and I have not managed this yet. What you do is you take your little finger, you take some vegetable oil, and you rub it in here to make the skin more transparent. Okay? Because the oil will go into the skin and will make it more transparent. And apparently, if you have the correct light coming in from the correct angle, and if you put it under the microscope, stereomicroscope, or maybe the 4x objective of your compound microscope and light up from the top, apparently over here you're able to see the red blood cells circulating around. Okay? Sometimes doctors use this as a test to check whether the blood circulation is fine. So I've not managed to do this yet, but apparently this is something that can be done. Yeah? If you numb your skin with ice before, that's something, okay? How can you prevent air bubbles? Difficult, okay? The bubbles in the nail polish form because the nail polish starts to contract together, yeah? What would win me a fight? A paramecium or an amoeba? If you got the paramecium or amoeba together, the amoeba will try to eat up the paramecium. There's some nice YouTube videos online about that, yeah? Some paramecia like to eat amoeba. Yeah. Why are the edges of the bubbles black? This is because there is a difference in the refractive index. That's the edges of the nail polish, and that is indeed one way why sometimes you're able to see certain things. Is this because of the differences of refractive index? Yeah. Because the way that the light is bent. Yeah. And you see, if I'm refocusing, it becomes darker. Yeah. Yeah, and here, yeah. So as a matter of fact, this is sometimes an advantage, because you're able to see structures that you are otherwise not able to see. Sometimes it's a problem. So it depends really, but this is because the mounting medium is clear, the air is clear, but because the refractive index is different, the light is bent, yeah, and jumps away and it becomes darker. Yeah. So what if an amoeba got in your hand? Well, this happens all the time when I go swimming in a natural pond environment. My skin is in contact always with different microorganisms. There are billions of them also growing, bacteria growing on my skin. The skin is an important protective layer. Most likely nothing is going to happen. What can happen is if there's a cut or an injury, then of course, and if the amount of microorganisms of a certain kind are too high, then an infection can happen. Yeah. Yeah. I would like to see that in one of your live streams. I don't now know exactly. I think the amoeba eating the paramecium. Yeah, I have to get a decently sized amoeba and some paramecia. We can put them together under the microscope, and then I'll maybe you're able to see them chase each other. So, but how are perfect air bubble circles made? Well, this they will go into a circle because of the surface tension. The surface tension causes the air bubbles. Yeah, because a bubble is the structure with the lowest surface area. That's why many objects, like for example oil and water and so on, will go into a circle. It has to do something with the surface area. So people, I want to slowly stop as well. Just a second, I need some tissue paper here, excuse me. So yeah, I made sure I got a stereo microscope with an illuminated base for leaf investigation and though, but I never tried a regular slides on it. Yeah, do that. If you have a stereo microscope, try some slides as well. I would like to see you observing with a stereo microscope one of your, yeah. Okay, yeah, so last week I did put a couple of insects also under the stereo microscope. So I'll do a little bit more because now that I have a nice stereo microscope as well. Yeah. By the way, I'm working on a review video of this stereo microscope as well, which will be published in my other channel where I put all the review videos. Yeah. I have a jar of water with dirty water in it, small life in it, like ciliates. But when will it really get loads of life? Honestly, it's normal. It's normal for a jar of water to have a progression. So this means that certain microorganisms will become more, others will become less. What you can try to do is you take out a small water sample and you add a small wheat grain, a little bit of food, a small amount. And after about 3 or 4 days, there will be a lot of paramecia in there, in this wheat grain. However, the number will again go down again as the food is used up and as they start to die off. So the idea is not the idea, but it's usually observed, is that there will be always some kind of a maximum, then it will go down. Yeah. If you overfeed it, bacteria are going to take over. Also, not always the. Just be careful, okay, so that you don't spill any of this stuff over your fingers, especially if you have a wound. And if you do, then just clean it off properly. Yeah, yeah. I put ants and roaches in there, and I put ants and roaches in there and cat food. Will that work? You mean into the honestly too much organic material. If you want to grow microorganisms, take a small amount. Otherwise, what's going to happen is that the bacteria are going to increase very quickly. They reproduce very fast and they will remove all of the oxygen. And then other microorganisms like ciliates, which need a lot of oxygen, they cannot grow. Okay, so getting the right balance is important. So, ladies and gentlemen, I hope that you liked the live stream. I'm going to leave it at that for today. Okay, I know it was at a slightly different time than normally. I hope that you still enjoyed it. Yeah, if you have any recommendations about any topics that you want me to talk about, please be free to suggest them. Sometimes I'm improvising also a little bit, so this means that depending on the comments in the chat, I might also deviate a little bit on the topic, but that's kind of part of the live stream here. Yeah, before you go, what about that? Is there a last question? If not, then yeah, you can post them also in the comments section below. And yeah, I think I'm going to leave it at that for today. I wish you all the best and happy microbe hunting as always, and see you around next time. Yeah, all the best.